Hello everyone. Thanks for joining me today. I have a really special guest today. Lisa Ling. I called her up because I wanted to talk to her a little bit more in depth of kind of what's been happening in the AAPI community. So I wanted to share with you all this conversation because I think it's incredibly important. Hey, Olivia. Thanks for joining. Let's see. Let me get her on now. Here we go.
Hello. There we are.
Hi, Lisa.
How are you? Hey, Harry. I'm well. How are you?
Good.
We finally made this happen.
I know. We've been
We tried to make it happen last week, and you know, you're an extremely busy person that has on the ground with everything that's been happening, and you know, dealing with kind of everything else that's been happening this whole last year. So I'm glad that we got to make
well,
this
parenting.
Happen.
So parenting is what's going on, you know. It's like I've got two crazy kids downstairs, and I'm like, I gotta go upstairs.
In a way it's like made it easier but also made it harder because you're like you're so close but yet you feel like you're too close at times to be able to even like focus right on whatever other tasks that you have to have at hand, right?
Oh, for sure. I mean, I'm someone who before the pandemic really tried to limit my kids on devices. Like I really, really tried and made a concerted effort. And then after the pandemic started, it's like, you know, whenever I need time alone to do any work, it's like, here's the iPad. It's just, it's really terrible. And I hope that once kids go back to school, we can start to kind of extract the devices from them. Although I hope that at this point it isn't like this genie that's already out of the bottle.
Yeah, no, I mean, look, I think it's also moving forward. It's finding a way to kind of, it's scary to say, but let that kind of be part of our system of like making you sure that that's for good use as opposed to like just pure entertainment, right? Because like, you know, one of my like nephews are like, is like coding already and like figuring, I'm sure he knows how to like, get into every system like that, you know, that I'm so like, wait, what are you doing?
Oh,
on the
yeah.
Computer? Even though I feel very savvy on the computer. The fact that I'm using the word savvy already, you know, makes me sound like an old man. But yeah. No, thank you so much for joining me. I know, you know, it's just for everyone who's joining right now. And I appreciate everyone who's coming on and to hear us kind of talk about this is, you know, the surge of attacks that have been happening in the Asian community, AAPI community, have been really horrific. And I, you know, growing up and coming to this country, I've experienced it. I've seen it. You know, it's happened to friends and certain family members. And it's, I feel it's more just, it's been happening for a long time. And just hasn't been properly reported, or you know, media hasn't put as much efforts in a lot of ways to report this properly, even though there's some good work that has been done.
Yeah.
But I think in mainstream wise, so you know, I wanted to get you have seen a lot of it. You've been you're first of all, Lisa is an award-winning journalist. She's done so much good work. You've had so many different platforms and has just been around to see so much happen over the years. So I just kind of wanted to hear your perspective and the things that you've been seeing, and hopefully, you know, seeing some light in the end of the tunnel in a lot of ways. But we'd love to hear on kind of like how you're processing all this right now.
Well, look, Harry, you're right. This has been happening, I think, a lot longer than we are acknowledging. This year, though, since the pandemic started, it really just has been a whole other level, and the attacks, the incident, hate-related incidents have just increased exponentially. But when I really stop and think about the trajectory of all of this, yes, it started to really rise, right? during the pandemic. But the truth of the matter is that I think so many of us who've grown up in this country, who were born in this country, have always kind of felt on the periphery. I know that when I was a kid, I grew up in a very non-diverse community. There were five kids in my high school who were Asian. Two of them had the last name, same last name, mine. And so I really felt very conflicted about my identity. My whole life, I never felt entirely American, nor did I really know anything about being Chinese. I would never want kids to come over to my house because it always smelled like Chinese food. And even though my father and my grandmother, who I lived with, spoke perfect English, my grandmother went to school at Cambridge in Oxford, and my father came here when he was 11, so he spoke perfect English. Whenever I had friends over, they just, for some reason, felt compelled to speak to me in Cantonese because I wanted to talk about my friend or whatever. And so I had a lot of shame about being Asian. And I think that a lot of, I'm certain that a lot of Asian people of my generation, I'm a bit older than you, had felt similarly. And I think that things have changed a bit with the younger generation, but now with the pandemic and these reminders, when the pandemic started of its origins, combined with the president referring to COVID as the China virus, it all compounded an already uncomfortable situation. And now we find ourselves in the situation today when it's really, honestly, Harry, as someone who was teased pretty relentlessly my whole life, my father was teased pretty relentlessly his whole life growing up where he grew up, where I grew up. My husband, who is 55, also was bullied growing up. It has reached a whole new level now because of COVID. In many ways, it's just it is exacerbated already existing tensions and levels of uncomfortability. So that's mm-hmm. kind of, you know, where we find ourselves. And so many of us are just, I mean, I'm losing sleep over this because social media also is allowing us to see some of these attacks that are happening, and they're just unconscionable and brutal and brazen. And, you know, these are people who look like us. These are our parents, our grandparents. So, it's just been a source of real pain and sadness over the last few months, and really, you know, this whole year. But again, is when I really stop and think about it, this has been ongoing for a long time.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. No. Thank you for sharing that, because I think we sometimes don't do that enough, sharing our stories and how we grew up, and we have nostalgia for certain parts of our lives and the things that we see, but we sometimes don't talk about the things that, you know, were maybe traumatic experience, or even those microaggressions that might seem harmless during that time, or even now that I think even some people are going through, some kids are going through now, that just may seem harmless, and you're able to clock it now as an adult, be like, that's actually going to be not that is going to be have an effect on not just the perpetrator or like the person saying these things, but or whether they're it's physical or verbal, but also, you know, obviously for the victim, that is going to over time they're going to somewhat hate themselves for who they are, which I think a lot of people can relate to, because, you know, we're all always playing different versions of ourselves, you know, no matter what, like with our parents and with our friends. And sometimes in some cases, when you're talking about the Asian American experience, is you're having to play that so you won't get beat up, or you're just hoping that they don't say something racist to you, because you're like, you don't know how to react or what to say, you know, because sometimes at the end of the day, it either ends up in violence, because that is the only way sometimes it'll result to, because we're not taught to, first of all, how to behave or to know how to say, like our parents, I don't know about you, but taught us like, just keep walking.
Yes.
Don't say anything. Don't make trouble. You know, I think that was like, they're always like, don't make trouble. It's just like, what does that fully mean, right? Because like, sometimes you're like, well, I'm not causing trouble. It's like, why is this being put on me for existing and just kind of being in my space or eating the foods that I grew up eating, you know, or speaking the language that is a language that is spoken by millions of people and just ends up being a really difficult thing to kind of process as a kid. So I think growing up and knowing that, I think for me that I wanted to have a conversation more so it's like, what are the roots of it all? And I think a lot of us do know what the roots of it all, but we're not having these like really full on conversation about how do we get here, right? How do we get to this place? And also hopefully we can talk about, and how do we fix it? Or how do we amend certain things that can at least drive us to a better place? You know, I don't think we're going to have a solution that's going to absolve it all, but at least get us to a better place.
Yeah. I mean, I think that there's a lot to unpack here, you know, it's so true. My husband, he's Korean American. And the only reason why he was able to survive, because he was teased and bullied pretty mercilessly, was because he was bigger than everyone else. My husband is 6'4". I think you've met him. He's a pretty giant Asian man. So he had that kind of going for him. He got in a lot of fights. And my father, who is the opposite, he was a very small man. He was teased pretty relentlessly, but he realized, like, if I become funny, if I'm the class clown, if I have a joke for everything, maybe I won't get the beat down. Mm. And so everybody has their way of dealing with it. I think the issue for my generation, and again, I'm older than you, so I don't know if your parents dealt with this.
You don't look it, Lisa.
In a similar way.
You look great. You look wonderful.
It's the ring light. But I never talked about being teased to my parents. I just sucked it up. And even though it wasn't malicious with me, I mean, I was name called every single day of my upbringing. And I think we were told that that's just what we're supposed to do, just kind of suck it up. And, you know, you'll get over it. My husband's father, it was almost like, I mean, he was loving toward my husband, but it was sort of like, you know, you have to learn how to deal with this. You know, we are very, you know, we're a different kind of parent now because we were raised in America. So we are much more engaged and communicative.
Yeah.
But for many of our parents who came here as immigrants, it's just not part of the culture to be communicative. And also I think that when our parents' generation and even our grandparents' generation came to this country, many of them came here with hopes of a better life. And so they settled in some cases in communities where other minorities lived, and they may not have really taken the time to understand the roots of the community, and they kind of set up shop. And as a result, tensions may have started brewing, you know, between the communities. And I think there's so many different, you know, every family has a different story, you know, immigration story to this country. But overall, I think it's fair to say that most of us have been taught that irrespective of how challenging things are, irrespective of what you may have encountered vis-a-vis bullying or teasing, you just kind of, you don't talk about it, you just deal with it, you overcome it. There isn't really a lot of emotional communication, and I think that's been a pretty big setback for us.
Yeah, I think you hit on something really important, and I think it's also, I think part of it, it's not saying like don't communicate, which is I think a part of it, but I think the big part of it is like, well, we don't even have the tools to even teach you how to communicate this thing, this emotion, or you know, and I think, you know, even getting into it, like understanding even mental health, like the idea of, you know, it's always, we're within the culture is always talking about good health, right, and wealth, and that, but the health in like not putting that in mental health as well. It's always talking about the organs and, like, you know, knowing how to, like, drink, what to drink to help solve this thing. And I don't think there's many drinks that can help solve mental issues in a lot of way that I think, and I think that previous generation, generations before that, that there is so much trauma that has happened, but it's almost become like just a matter of, you know, someone who is able to practice suppressing their emotions. Like, they do it so, it's done so well to the point where it feels normal. And it feels like, well, this, I've accomplished this, like this, I'm fine. And I think, you know, and unpacking all that now and the newer generation that is starting to really figure out, like, wow, we're seeing more examples of, oh, this person spoke out, this person that did this. And now they seem like they're a lot more, like, lighter and just happier and able to at least move forward in life. And, you know, I going back to, I think a lot of outside of what the, and I don't want to say with the Asian AAPI community, like, I think it's very different in a lot of smaller pockets and community that might not get as much of a voice, that almost seem invisible within the community too, which, you know, so I don't want to overgeneralize within the community, but I think a big part of it is that we never had specifically during this time when we're talking about all these attacks happening and trying to have people speak up and find leaders, is there wasn't very many leaders that were written in books, that have, like, movies watch, right?
Yeah, you're touching on what I think is one of the most important pieces here, one of the most important components, which is history is, American history at least, has always been told through a certain lens, through a particular perspective. And so those of us who have grown up in the American education system have grown up exposed to that kind of history. I don't think that I ever heard about what happened to the over 100,000 Japanese Americans during World War II until I was long out of high school. I was actually trying to think about whether I had any exposure whatsoever to Asian American history as a high school student or before. And I honestly could not think of a single, you know, outside of, you know, the Chinese helped build the railroads. Outside of that, I really was so naive to the role that Asians have played in the construction and the evolution of this country. And I think that therein lies a major problem. And I think that what's been happening now, as devastating as it's been, the one kind of silver lining in all of this is that it's just galvanized the Asian community. It's propelled us to want to understand our history more. It's propelled us to want to raise our voices. It's propelling us to want to speak out. And it's propelling us to also unify. Mm. You know, we always talk about how the Asian community is not monolithic, and it's not. It's comprised of so many different ethnicities and incredible cultures. But there is something to be said about the Asian American experience that we all collectively share with one another. But to really kind of appreciate that categorization, I think it's really important that we understand our historical roots in this country. And I happen to just, like, pull a couple of books off of my shelf, Minor Feelings, which Kathy Park Hong wrote. I mean, if you are really interested in figuring out what kind of Asian identity is about, I mean, so many Asians, like, have all these feelings that they aren't really able to articulate. She does a really great job. She's blunt and just, she expresses all of those minor feelings that so many of us have grown up harboring for so long. I loved Interior Chinatown, which won the National Book Award last year. It's such an innovative, inventive.
I read that in 2 days.
Isn't it incredible? But yet it's so layered and so rich.
And it's very smartly done. Like, just it just felt fresh and new, to a new way of storytelling, and still just rich in history of, like, some of the things I didn't know, some of the things you did know, but you never saw it in that perspective. And I just think that he just did a wonderful job.
Well, you know, it's interesting, Harry, because as an actor, you know, this book is written in like a teleplay form, like a script.
That's why.
And all of the characters are called things like generic Asian man, good looking black cop, kung fu man. They're all these like very cliched, generic terms. And that was intentional, because the author, that those were the kinds of characterizations that he, you know, experienced watching media of Asian people. They were always like kind of the people off to the side. They weren't the lead. You know, they didn't have the lead roles except for Kung Fu Guy.
Yes.
They were just kind of generic. And I wonder for you as an actor, what your perspective of, you know, Asian America was growing up based on the things that you grew up watching.
I mean, look, I don't like to say I have a unique experience, because it's not, because I think a lot, you know, I didn't realize that a lot of people were experiencing the same thing, you know, even though I moved from a different country, and whether it was a Latin country or Asian country, it mattered to a certain point. You still feel an outsider when you kind of move into America, so everything feels new and fresh, and I just remember always I was a very loud child, you know, in Costa Rica. I was just and when I came here, I just got extremely shy, became more introvert, or lean towards that side more. And I was became an observer, and anytime something would happen to me, you know, and, you know, I would have points when I would get beat, you know, and not to the point where like I'm bloodied, but enough to be like, why are you hitting me? You know, when I remember when I first moved and hearing words like, you know, go back to your country, chink. And I was like, you want me to go back to Costa Rica? Like, I just don't understand. Mm-hmm. Like, why you want me to go back there? And then, you know, people not associating with what your face looks like was just one country. And
did you feel that? Did you feel that in Costa Rica?
I didn't. I think I was too young to really realize if that did happen. But I for the most part, my parents, they learned the language pretty quickly. I feel like they were able. The one thing I'm really thankful for, my parents are just like, just learn about the culture that you're in, the place that you're in, you know, just learn as much about it, and, you know, be an observer, and then you can show beauties of your culture, right? So I really believe that to still, no matter what, wherever you go, if you visit, I don't know, like you visit Brazil, you visit Italy, like learn about the culture, accept it, you know, and learn about the people there, and hopefully in turn that. You know, I think what's always interesting is when someone, specifically if you go to, I don't know, even to China, and like a white dude speaks Mandarin, they're just like, oh, I don't think it's a surprise of, obviously the language is maybe a little harder to learn than other ones, but it's the fact that like, we're not used to you liking our culture enough to learn the language and like it. And I think that always played in my mind of like, well, I want to learn about as many cultures within the space that I'm in, whether it be on television, and I relate it to them in a lot of ways. And I found empathy through that, which I think, you know, a lot of times it's to me, that's always been my mission. And it's why it's so important for representation, but specifically proper ones where, you know, people behind the camera or in front of the camera are in tune with the culture as opposed to just what we look like, to what story you're telling. So, you know, it's,
and you know, I actually find that, you know, this country, you know, we are really just like this amalgam of so many different cultures and histories. And there are incredible opportunities within our own country to explore entirely different cultures than your own.
Absolutely.
In this country. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, as a journalist who gets to do this show, you know, called This Is Life, I'm able to really immerse myself in cultures that are very different from mine, but in our own backyard in the United States. And, you know, I think that this pandemic has really, you know, we've become so much more isolated. And so we're finding ourselves, we're on social media so much, and we're yelling at each other with our thumbs rather than really engaging. And I hope that when we are able to come out of this, and we will, that we will all sort of recognize the importance of engaging with each other, human to human. I mean, you talk about really familiarizing yourself with other cultures when you get an opportunity to visit other countries. And I would say there are incredible opportunities.
Do it here.
Right. Yeah, in your neighborhood. There are probably parts of your neighborhood, or your community rather, that you've never even ventured into. And my hope is that we will recognize that when we come out of COVID and take the opportunity to really engage. And before COVID, I used to try to kind of get to know a new person every day. You know, when you go to the grocery store, or when you're, you know, walking down the street, you probably see the same people, your mail carrier, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
How much do we take the time to really get to know anybody anymore? And I think COVID has really made this so much more challenging, obviously, right? Mm-hmm. But what if we did that? You know, what if we all sought out to better understand our fellow Americans just a little bit better? We might not be in this predicament, because we know that our history has not done a really good job of really exposing the diversity, the incredible diversity, and how multifaceted our history is. So what if we took the initiative and really tried to leave our bubbles? I mean, when you think about how we interact day to day, and how much of a role social media plays in our lives right now. You know, we follow the same the people who espouse the same political positions, who espouse the same, you know, similar ideas. And so therefore our bubbles become smaller. And so when you exist in these bubbles, you essentially isolate yourself from everyone else. And I think that's why we've gotten to this place where we're all like hypersensitive. We're all feeling tense. We're seeing on social media things that incite us. And we're not even getting into like these algorithms that are feeding us information. Yes. That's a whole other topic altogether. But, you know, I think that what we're all just really missing is that opportunity to just, you know, have communion with one another and recognize our shared humanity. And I really hope that we all try to do that when we are able to.
Yeah, you are. I mean, you're saying something that I think is so important, that just like getting out of our social bubbles, and whatever that may look like for, you know, I think it varies for a lot of people, but I think COVID has been such a huge test on what we're going to do after this, right? How are we going to interact after this? And, you know, obviously us talking through this, even on Instagram Live, I don't think that's going to change. But I think it's making sure that we are maybe even using this as a tool to connect with people that aren't, that don't have the exact same views or experiences or come from the same place. And I think one of the things that I've taken away is the whole just unlearning the things that we've learned. A lot of times we always emphasize on like, oh, we didn't learn enough. We didn't learn this thing before. My hopes and dreams is to actually every day, or even every month or every year, to look back and be like, I was pretty dumb back then. I think there's a new way of looking at that. I'm not saying you're dumb, like, and beating yourself up over, but like, you should be. You should actually be tested on kind of the things that you thought were normal and you thought were fine, and saying like, actually, no, that wasn't. Let me learn more about this and unlearn a lot of things that kind of have maybe allowed us to coast through without realizing that things were problematic. You know, that maybe we were had a hand in enabling in a lot of ways.
Yeah, I agree with you. Yeah, and I think now that we are, you know, I think culturally, you know, we've become more woke, right? you know, we almost have an obligation to, just given what we have learned, to really reflect back and almost break a generational cycle of ignorance, right? Again, you know, so many of our family members, when they came to this country, they didn't really take the time to understand the roots of their community, because they were so intent on just survival and trying to exist. And so, you know, if we build a store, or if we, you know, if we don't acknowledge the community that was here before us, so, you know, so what? You know, because America sort of symbolizes for a lot of people a new beginning, right? Mm-hmm. And so why would I need to take the time to understand, again, the history of our roots? And I think what we're going through right now, and I think this summer's BLM protests and the movement, is that we're all kind of going through this reckoning, where we're having to ask ourselves, you know, we're having to kind of look back on the history that we were taught, and now look at what, you know, and when we listen to other communities and say, well, somehow this doesn't match what I learned here, or somehow, like, I'm hearing this perspective that doesn't quite sound like what I grew up reading. Could there be something to that? And it's really requiring a kind of critical thinking that we may not have really been given the tools to be able to do growing up, because, again, our history was told through a certain lens. So, you know, I'm hoping, I think it's also very easy to, with the internet, with social media, like, we're so inundated with information, you know, we're so overwhelmed, but we still have to be careful at the same time, because, you know, social media, like, it hits you instinctively. You see something that hurts you, or you see something that is horrific, and your compulsion is to just react, rather than really, like, taking a breath and trying to understand the context. And I think that applies to so many things in our life, like, that we really need to stop and take note of that, like, okay, I'm really, like, I'm feeling these things really viscerally, but I really need to give myself a moment to try and, one, process, but two, understand the context. And, you know, I think that right now, with all of these attacks against Asians, you know, we cannot deny that they have increased, you know, by 2,000% in this country, which is astounding. These aren't all attacks. These are hate-related incidents that are being reported. But I do think that it is important to actually, you know, understand, you know, something that we see on social media, to really kind of take that time to kind of understand as much as we can about it before we may start to repost it or retweet it. Because context does matter. And I know, as a journalist, I'm as guilty as the next person of wanting to just retweet right away if something really incites me. And I know I need to do a better job of just, like, okay, let's try to read about what I'm seeing. Let's try to ask questions before we react.
Is it helpful for the bigger picture? That's really what it's like. Sometimes it's hard, right, to differentiate, and you making that choice as an individual, like, is my contribution by, like, sharing this actually helpful for the greater good of trying to make things better, right? And what is that reason? Just me feeling a certain way? And I, you know, and that's why I really wanted to talk to you, because I think it just shows an example of people having a little more of these conversations, because we're you know, I think obviously after that is putting an action to it and finding ways. But I think there's just so many people in this world, and not everyone can fix one thing. And I think people have to do it in different ways, in the ways that they feel that they can really positively contribute. And sometimes it is speaking out and being a true activist that is leading the charge to create change. And some people are doing it in different forms, whether through in their art or obviously being a journalist and reporting the stories properly. But having these shared experiences and sharing these moments, I think, is incredibly important. And we're not doing that enough. And also, like, you know, your experience, we might have some relatable experiences, but it's not exactly the same, you know, from your upbringing to the people that you have come in contact with is what makes you unique and beautiful. And so I that's why I just encourage more people to have these conversations, and specifically within their community. But I, you know, talking about what we're talking about right now within the Asian American community or Asian Pacific Islander community, that you know, I think other countries are dealing with the same thing. There's attacks happening in Australia. There's attacks happening in UK. It's terrible in very many in a lot of places where people are afraid to go and walk outside. My mom is just like, well, I've been staying home all day because I'm not trying to be one of the victims.
Is your family in the Bay Area?
She's in San Leandro, so it's not far from Oakland, and you know, it's something that they talk within the community. Don't go out there. And, you know, I hope that what we're doing right now is also having conversations with the other communities that, which is happening. And I think actively doing, that people are doing. And I think that is a wonderful thing. And going back to, I think what has been great, is you know a lot more about it, but then obviously I posted something about this hashtag stop Asian hate, but Gold House and GoFundMe, they partnered up and did this really beautiful thing. So it's just allowed this kind of central hub to be able to figure out how to donate and help victims that are struggling after these attacks, and also these are organizations that are providing support and safety in certain in local communities, which I think it all starts there. Because you can talk on a federal, whole United States, you can't fix everything. It's all about community and where we can do that. So I think if people are really interested and really want to help, they can go to gofundme.com/AAPI. You can find an organization that you feel comfortable donating to. They're all been vetted. The Gold House and GoFundMe have done a wonderful job vetting, so they're legit organizations and charities.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought it up. I was going to on this IG as well. You know, my good friend Philip Lim, the designer. Oh my God, he's one of the most passionate people I know. He has been instrumental in setting this up, along with Bing Chen, who's the founder of Gold House, who you know, who I also adore. And so many people have been asking, well, you know, we've been just hearing about these rampant attacks, like, how can I donate to this family and this family? And I want to understand what this organization, or where can I donate to, or an organization that wants to try and combat hate. And what's great about what GoFundMe is doing is that it's providing one platform that people can go to, and they can choose to donate to the various victims or their families. And you can also read about the myriad of organizations that are working to combat hate, to strengthen communities. There are some restorative justice organizations. And so it's one place. And it's been a long time coming. I'm so grateful that resource has become available. If you just, again, Harry just mentioned it, but if you go to GoFundMe and just search AAPI, it'll come up. And it's, that is the thing that is giving me light and giving me hope. And that is just that the community, the Asian community, is coming together in a way that I've never experienced before. And there has just been so much overwhelming support from outside of the Asian community, because everybody is horrified by what's been happening. And I also think that but people outside of the Asian community, I think they're stopping and thinking, like, you know, I really don't know about, you know, the history of Asian America. And I really, you know, I think a lot of people are hearing for the first time about the catastrophic struggles and gross discrimination that Asians have experienced since the beginning of this country and how it's continued to persist, but hasn't really been discussed. And I think that this is a real like moment of inflection and a galvanizing moment. And that is really, it's inspiring me and giving me hope. I mean, again, so many of these people are a lot younger than I am. Mm-hmm. But just to hear, you know, we did this big clubhouse a couple of weeks ago. We had like 4,000 people show up. And when we were listening to people just talk about their stories, it was like, wow, there's so many similarities to what I grew up feeling, but I just didn't have that. I wasn't aware of the extent to which people kind of experience these things that I did. And so just to have this community that can share and become communicative with one another has been really heartening, and I've been really grateful for that.
Yeah, it's really beautiful, the outpouring that is happening. People finally feeling okay to speak up and speak their truth. And you know, I also want to emphasize, you know, I know it's important to, when you talk about Asian American history and even Black history, that it's just American history. It is part of America. It is what the contributions that everyone has made. And you know, that's for another conversation on how it's, a lot of times it's been erased or, you know, kept on the sidelines. So I think it's important to tell these stories.
It's so true. I mean, you really stop and think about it. Who are the arbiters of American history, right? Because you and I are just as much American as anyone else with different, you know, with who looks different, right? We are just as American as anyone else, but yet why isn't the history of those who resemble us told in our history books? And I'm hoping that changes. I mean, you know, I have a 7-year-old and a 4-year-old. I know you have a baby girl, and I'll be honest with you, I have not discussed with my kids. I have a very sensitive 7-year-old, and I have talked to her about racism. We've read books about discrimination, intersectionality, but I am really conflicted about how to tell her that people who look like her are being brazenly attacked. You know, it's one thing to talk about how you know, how I was teased as a kid, and to be aware that, you know, there's superficial teasing that happens and that can happen, but this idea that people are being attacked just because of what they look like, because of their skin color, in such horrific ways is just, I feel really conflicted right now about it. I'll be honest.
Yeah. It's hard to teach a child who knows that it's wrong, doesn't understand why it is exactly, but to know that it is says something about the kind of like, how it's wrong, first of all, and then like how humans learn that behavior over time, you know, whether it be the environment they're in or whether it be parenting or stuff that they've seen over time as being just part of the system. So I hope that people that are watching are just, you know, watch a doc, pick up a book or, you know, do some research. And as I think it's important, wherever you are, whatever part of the world you are at, there is a part of, there's a lot of the history that you didn't realize. And that kind of always draws back to what we're dealing with now. So I think that's the most important. That's been so eye-opening for me over time. And that takes a lot of, no one's going to feed it to you. And if you let it, you're going to be steered the wrong direction a lot of ways. So I think you know, what you always said, like critical thinking and being able to say, hey, this is wrong. Why is it wrong? Let me learn more about this. I just think that's the best way to go. So, I mean, look, I don't want to take too much time away from your kids. I know I got to go back and be a dad. You can go back and be a mom. But I, you know, I really appreciate you. I really appreciate your honesty and all the work that you have been doing and continue to do. So we're all, I think, not just the people in the community, but I think a lot of people are championing folks like you that are telling the truth and being out there and just you know, in a lot of ways, kind of filling, because there's so much empathy, I think, that happens when you hear these stories, but so much you're getting secondhand trauma in a lot of ways too, because you're constantly seeing this. You have to dissect this. Yeah. You have to know how to formulate it to get it out there to the public, and hopefully that they can digest it in a way that seems like they'll want to learn more of. So I appreciate all the work that you're doing.
Well,
so
thanks, Harry, and thank you for wanting to have the conversations. I've checked out a number of your IG lives, and I really appreciate that it is important enough for you to really drill down and to go deep and to talk about things that may really hurt us and things that are challenging that we're dealing with. And I think that only when we can bring a lot of that stuff right to the surface and really communicate about it, can we ever really overcome it. You know, we have to dig deep and bring it up. And I think for too long, particularly in the Asian community, we've just been suppressing all this stuff and really kind of unable, and we haven't really known how to express it, right? Or because we've been told that we shouldn't, or that we should kind of keep our heads down. And so I want to just continue to encourage people to just, you know, to give people permission to feel and talk, because this is a moment when I think we're all trying to figure out, you know, what to do, what to say, but how to be here for each other. And it gives me comfort to know that right now the community is strong and becoming increasingly more unified and really just is eager to not only learn and absorb, but to act.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you so much for that. And before we end this, the two books, because I think people have been asking, what are the books that they can read? And I have one.
Minor Feelings.
Interior
Chinatown. Very different. I also, just in case the Asian Black Solidarity Movement goes way back. And there's a woman who, if you don't know who she is, I'm actually working on a film about this woman, Yuri Kochiyama, with Nina Yang Bon Jovi, who I think you might know. And it's interesting because I've been pitching a film about Yuri's life and wanting to do something about Yuri Kochiyama's life for more than a decade. And every time I would ask people in the Asian community about her, they would have no idea. But if you ask activists in the Black community, they all know who she is. Like she was a radical in her time. She actually passed away not too long ago. But there are just these incredible, incredible figures throughout Asian American history that I just encourage those who are watching to try to get to know, because they're really complex, but they're really, really inspiring.
That's wonderful. I'm gonna have to check that one out as well. And thank you again for coming on. And this is very insightful, and I really enjoyed this. You know, no one really wants to talk about these hard. Like, I want to have a drink and talk about the sky turning blue, but like, you know, this is the work that needs to be done and the conversations that need to be had. So I really appreciate you. And hopefully after this is all done, we can go and have a drink with, or a punch with the kids.
Yes. Yes. We'll have a play date. Yeah. Give my love to the family.
You too. Thank you so much, Lisa.
Thanks, Harry. Have a good night.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye, everyone. Bye.